Hello everyone! Now we're going to take a look at one of the two most important equations in electrochemistry, the Nernst equation. This is how the Nernst equation looked like. It was found out when we were looking at different electrochemical cells and we were trying to find out what condition does change the potential how. And then we found the Nernst equation. And the important part is the Nernst equation first only describes one half cell. So we're looking at like one metal sheet, for example, in water. And then we can use the Nernst equation for both sides of this cell, and then we know what the potential difference between both of them is. What is now in the Nernst equation? Which parameters are we looking at? We want to calculate the potential of our system, so the potential is in there. Then we have a second potential there, the standard potential. So you need to know your redox potential under standard conditions if you want to use the Nernst equation. Then you have the temperature, the numbers of electrons that are exchanged. So in your reaction, if you oxidize copper to copper 2, there are two electrons that you remove from the copper, so that will be a 2. We have two constants here. We have the Faraday constant and the universal gas constant. They're always the same. Then we have the logarithm of the ratio of the activity of the oxidized species and the activity of the reduced species. That is all quite a lot. And to be honest, most of the times you will not use this general form, but you will simplify the whole thing a bit. We have, for example, usually the same temperature, around 25 degrees. We usually don't have a big difference between activity and concentration, and it's a lot easier to work with concentrations. So we can take the activity coefficients out of this logarithm, put them into the standard potential, and also logarithms with a base of e are a bit difficult. Let's turn them into the logarithm with a base of 10. So then we end up with this version of the equation where we have this fixed number in there, but we also now have the formal potential. It's no longer the standard potential, but like a slightly different potential. We have now the logarithm to the base 10, and we use the concentration instead of the activity. The Nernst equation does one more nice thing. So if we really, really condense it down on the Nernst equation, it mainly is the relationship between the potential of an electrode and the ratio of oxidized and reduced species in front of the electrode. Up to now, we've only used that into one direction, right? We always looked at, hey, how is the potential influenced by the chemical environment? Because we were building like little batteries. But we can flip this around. Also, the potential can determine the chemical environment. So let's say we have an electrode and in front of it we have a certain ratio of the O and the R, so the oxidized and reduced species, and now we increase the potential. Then we see that we have more O than before, and if we increase even further, we even have more O. This way, the Nernst equation also describes how systems act when the potential is the limiting factor. And you can see that in different measurements, for example, in linear sweep voltammetry. But it's not the only influence, so you will see that as well, things like diffusion. Now you know what the Nernst equation describes. If you want to see it in action, you can do that with almost any electrochemical technique. What about linear sweep voltammetry, for example? And all our potentiostats can do that. Have a great day. Thanks for watching.